watching the ZNS Network, the People's Station.
My fellow Bahamians, good evening. Tonight, I speak to you directly, to you, my people. Tonight, no man can deny that we have come a long way. But I hasten to warn you that we still have a long, long way to go. But thank God, we have overcome. If you fail, you fail me, and then I shall fail you. I do not wish to fail, so I ask you, please, please, don't fail me. I thank you all from the bottom of my heart. Prayers surely change things.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the entrance of the Most Honorable Dame Margaret Pindling, Order of the Nation, Grand Cross of the Most Distinguished Order of St. Michael and St. George. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the Most Honorable Dame Margaret Pindling and her family. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Honorable Philip Brave Davis, KC, Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Please remain standing for the national anthem of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, performed by the Royal Bahamas Police Force Band. This will be followed by prayer by the Reverend Dr. William Thompson, Senior Pastor, Faith United Baptist Church. Ladies and gentlemen, the national anthem of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. We pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we humbly and boldly approach your throne of grace and enter into divine presence, thanking you first for the precious gift of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And God, we come boldly before your throne, thanking you, God, for this privilege and opportunity of prayer. God, we come at this most special moment in our nation's history to thank you for your grace and mercies that has brought us to this hour of celebration. We thank you, God, for the life, work, and legacy of Sir Lyden Pindling, who we honor tonight. Thank you, God, that he emptied himself for the Bahamian people that we may have a better life. We pray for their wife and widow, Dame Pindling. We pray for his children and all his family members. Indeed, God, we present them before you at this special hour, that you will give them the assurance that you are with them and you are continuously with this country. Now, God, we leave this all in your care. We ask you, God, to bless the proceedings tonight, that everything will be done to bring honor to your name and indeed to lift up this country. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Kindly be seated.
I think his great magic, his great political magic, as I said earlier, was his ability to connect with people in a way that allowed them to connect with him. You know, we have an expression that there are what we call Pindling PLPs,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
You know, I consider myself a Pindling PLP,
yes.
Right? And there are thousands, yes, of people like that, mm-hmm, who, and that's their way of saying that they think that their view of politics, their view of the party, is informed primarily by the experience they had with Lyden Pindling. He was the ultimate leader He just encapsulated so many virtues of leadership that one could not help but to be drawn to him.
Please welcome Her Excellency Leslie Miller Bryce, Bahamas's ambassador to CARICOM and chair of the National Independent Secretariat, who will deliver welcome remarks.
The Honorable Philip Brave Davis, Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, to Dame Marguerite Pindling and the Pindling family, to Chief Justice, Right Honorable Ian Winder and Mrs. Winder, to the Leader of His Majesty's Loyal Opposition, represented by the Honorable Shannon Dawn Cartwright, to the President of the Senate and members of the Senate, to the Speaker of the House of Assembly and members of the House of Assembly, to our viewing audience online, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, good evening. How can we celebrate without acknowledgement of our history? How can we celebrate without pausing to reflect, dig deep, and gain an appreciation for the life and legacy of the father of our nation, Sir Lyden Oscar Pindling, and by extension, Dame Marguerite and her children? What is national success without sacrifice? What is national development without leadership? And what is a life well lived without the building of a legacy? I have the privilege of welcoming you all within these halls and virtually to an evening of such reflection, distinguished insight, and conversation from men and women that led with Sir Lyden Pindling, served with him, loved him, and supported him. I welcome you to an historic evening of education, celebration, and appreciation. This evening will highlight Sir Lyden Pindling, the leader, the visionary, the husband, the father, the mentor, and one of the leading hands who was pivotal in building our nation. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my hope that you came hungry this evening. I don't mean in a physical state of hunger, although our reception to follow is expected to be delicious. I mean hungry to learn more, and that you await to be refueled and energized by the stories, the wisdom, and the experiences shared here this evening. I welcome you to truly pause and partake of this feast of knowledge, feast of memories, this feast of inspiration that should motivate us all to press on, build upon, and move forward together to achieve more, do more, and be more as a nation. World-renowned poet Maya Angelou said, "Do the best you can until you know better. Then when you know better, do better." For 50 years, we've done the best we can. However, it is the expectation and hope of the National Independent Secretariat that as you take part in this evening's discussions, attend the ongoing lecture series and other historical reenactments and discussions this year, you will then know better so that we as a nation can strive to do better. I seek to challenge us all to learn more about our forefathers and foremothers that have led the foundation for this country to not only be independent, but to thrive as regional leaders and global champions, to learn more about our leaders, their leadership styles, their accomplishments, their policies, and their key decisions that have shaped the country we know today, to learn more about their commitment to mentorship, their dedication to service and to this country as they pave the way for other leaders and our future leaders, to learn more so that you know what to be proud of, You better understand how far we've come and use what we've done right to help us to achieve so much more. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I am certain tonight's feast will surely be nourishing to our minds, our hearts, and to the Bahamian spirit to celebrate, but most importantly, build upon the legacy of the one and only Sir Lyden Oscar Pindling. Bon appetit.
Your Royal Highness, Your Excellencies, Honorable Ministers, Senators, Members of Parliament, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters.
Many people in many lands have talked about democracy, but have not seen it demonstrated fully in their own land. We have, thank God. Many people in many lands cry for power to be taken to the people. We don't have to, thank God. Power was taken by the people a long time ago, and that is where it shall stay.
As head of the government, I feel a deep sense of responsibility in leading our country into independence. And I hope that all my fellow Bahamians everywhere would share this feeling and sense that many new and pressing demands will be made upon them in the interests of our beloved nation. You would know that it took a great deal of hard work to reach this glorious point in our history in order to fulfill our true and great destiny. As we lift up our heads to the sun rising over our beautiful Bahama land, let us all march on to glory, steadfast in our Christian heritage. With faith in God and faith in our country and people, we can rise to whatever heights we aspire to, and these can be achieved by our continuing efforts. My fellow Bahamians, our raised flag is the signal of a new era for all Bahamians, a signal for us to take our place among the free nations of the world. We must remember that all of us are partners in this great effort to build a better Commonwealth of the Bahamas.
Now the sun rises from an azure sea to symbolize the dawning of a new day in our Bahamas. that national day of celebration and that year of Jubilee 1973, when independence would be proclaimed for our Commonwealth of the Bahama Islands. And together, we and generations to follow will stride with confidence forward, upward, and onward.
Sir Lyndon was for a few years premier before he became prime minister, so that was even an earlier age. I think those few years that he was premier helped him to find a stride at that early age in his 30s, I think, late 30s. And so when he became prime minister in 1973, I believe his age provided him with the depth of energy, enthusiasm, and initiative.
I think it should be understood that even though Sir Lyndon was 43 when majority rule came about and he became the premier of the country, he was vastly experienced. He was also joined by colleagues who were diversely and vastly experienced. Sir Lyndon had been elected in 1956, so he had 11 years as a member of parliament.
Hi, the position is that we get in life. A true leader is one who is never too tall to stoop to hear even the lowest cry from the least of the least. And I think Sir Lyndon was born with that. He was an only child, father and mother. The family unit was in place. And I think he grew up with, you know, as they said, manners will take you around the world. And so I think that he had it. He was really a people's person. No matter who you were, no matter where you went, your port wasn't too black for him not to accept what you had to eat. He was just a wonderful person. And all through history, whatever, whether it was in time, ancient or modern, there's only one person that comes and leads at a time, one Moses, one Joshua, one Esther. And in the case of this great country of ours, one Lyndon. Imitated, but never duplicated.
I am pleased to invite the Honorable Obi Wilchcombe, MP, Minister of Social Services and Urban Renewal, and Dr. Debbie Bartlett, renowned broadcaster, to share their personal experiences with us. Ladies and gentlemen, Minister Wilchcombe and Dr. Bartlett.
So wonderful to be here this evening. I recognize the Honorable Prime Minister, the Chairman of our Independence Committee. Ambassador, so good to see your wonderful remarks welcoming us all here this evening. Of course, the Dame. Always great to see you, Dame Marguerite. And of course, very rarely, Obi, good to see you, Monique, Leslie, good to have the family and a very rare opportunity to get an inside discussion on the family, Sir Lyndon Pindling, the father, the grandfather, the husband, the father of the nation. Now, earlier this evening, we saw some clips,
And one of the great things about those clips is that it represented individuals who spent so much time with Sir Lyndon, got to know him so well. Sean McQueenie is one of them. Sean McQueenie is here. So good to see you, Sean. Sean McQueenie, and I remember, and we're sharing and we're reflecting. I remember that very last speech Sir Lyndon was to give in the House of Assembly on his leaving the House. And I remember you and him working tirelessly to cause that to happen. He really respected Sean McQueenie's brilliance. And Sean, you were like one of his sons as well. So it's so wonderful to see you here this evening. We also have individuals who you might have seen in one of the clips. He was Sir Lyndon's best friend, I would say, particularly when they traveled. He's here this evening. His name is Felix Mailman Bo. He's right here. Very rarely does anybody talk about Felix Mailman Bo, but for many years he served as his NGC member in South Andros. And when Sir Lyndon was in Andros, he was there. When Sir Lyndon was not in Andros, he was there. So it's so good to see you out here this evening. Of course, former Prime Minister Perry Christie, who shared a wonderful relationship with Sir Lyndon. Perry Christie will tell you the story of how they were in London and Sir Lyndon invited him over to a lunch or dinner when he was a student. And of course, Christie being as gregarious as he is and very conversational, truly impressed Sir Lyndon, and then he was appointed senator, one of the youngest senators ever in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. He was called home to serve in the Senate. Good to see you, the Honorable Perry Christie. Sir Lyndon always searched for young people, always wanted young people involved. He always wanted to renew and cause young people to have an opportunity. And that is how I got on the stage. That's how my good friend and family member and colleague, Debbie Bartley, got on the stage, because we covered Sir Lyndon and we were broadcasters who truly appreciated it. And then later I entered into politics, but Debbie said no, she would not.
No, I prefer broadcasting. Can I just say, welcome, welcome, welcome. This is a historic night. I am so happy to be a part, and I have to give my mentor, the minister who allowed me to cover the Pindling family, Sir Lyndon, and Mother of Our Nation. Let's give them a round of applause. It is absolutely such an honor, and I believe that this is the launching pad for the greatest and strongest next 50 years, because we have a strong foundation laid by the father of our nation. But, you know, I decided to stay in the lane of a journalist, and I must tell you that my first introduction to father of our nation was when Minister Wilshcombe sent me to the carnival with Sir Lyndon. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do.
And he made me feel as though that was the biggest assignment in the world, going to the carnival with the Prime Minister of the Bahamas. And I understood that is how Sir Lyndon felt, because he made, as Mr. McQueenie said, as the former Prime Minister said, he makes ordinary people feel as though they are great. And I watched him just love the disabled. And he tried to speak to everyone in that carnival site. And so that was my introduction. And we went on later, you would remember, then he graduated me so that I could do a little bigger assignments.
Earlier this week in the Parliament, we reflected on Sir Lyndon Pindling's birthday. 93rd birthday would have been this past Wednesday. 2 days before, it would have been Sir Cecil Wallace Whitfield's birthday, also 93 years old. Now, what's important of this story is that many thought they were adversaries. Many thought that they did not get along, did not like each other. They had their political differences. But I tell you very quickly a story. When we were in Barbados attending the Caribbean Development Bank meeting, Sir Lyndon was sitting in the session, phone call came, his aide came and got him, He left the session and never returned. He spent the entire day out of the session. When we were finished, he went to his room and we said to London, what happened? He said, bad news about Sir Cecil. He has cancer and it doesn't look good. And then he returned to his room. Didn't come out anymore that evening. That spoke volumes of their relationship. And then when we were flying home, I said, you know, that was interesting. And he said, if it wasn't for Sir Lyndon and for Sir Cecil and my wife, I would not be here today. He was making a point about what happened in 1967 when he was still in London and dealing with matters of state, trying to get the party recognized, trying to get the Home Secretary to see where we wanted to take this country. And he almost did not have the opportunity to nominate. And Sir Cecil, who led the party as chairman of the party at the time, led it. And Dame Marguerite, you were there, and you almost became the candidate. The interesting story about Sir Lyndon is, as Loftus Roker said, you know, when I interviewed Sir Cecil told me, he said, you know, Pindling had this incredible ability. You know, you would get killed politically, but don't know you're dead until you're walking down the street and you realize something happened to you. The truth is, his ability to communicate, and he never wanted anyone to feel badly about their dreams or aspirations. In fact, the Honorable Philip Brave Davis will tell you the story of how Sir Lyndon would always say, what'd the fellas say? He never said him. What did the fellas do? Oh, I'm going to deal with that. He was always taking care of matters. Sir Lyndon was one of the greatest leaders this country would ever see because of all he did for this Commonwealth of the Bahamas and how he made all of us feel. I remember when I wanted to become chairman of the PLP, and he asked me, he said, I understand you want to run for chairman. I said, yes, sir. I thought, you know, I went to a meeting, and I heard people shouting, Obi Wilskin, Obi Wilskin, Obi Wilskin, and I was ready. He said, well, what do you know about the party? I said, well, I'm with you a lot. I could learn. He said, no, it's not the question. The question is, what do you know about the party? I said, not much. He said, don't you think you should learn first? 2 years later, he touched me one day. He said, don't you want to run for chairman of the party? I said, well, you said I'm not ready. He said, you're ready now. In other words, he made sure. And I learned the lesson that prior preparation prevents poor performance. And I'll never forget that because you might think you are. And for us younger politicians at the time, you may have the ego and think that you're ready because someone called your name, but not necessarily. And that was a lesson to learn.
It's amazing that you said that, because one of the things that I think is such a powerful quality of Sir Lyndon is his compassion, and he is concerned with everyone that he meets and really of the people of the Bahamas. Why did I say that? I did not know him. And I determined that I wanted to be an entrepreneur at ZNS. And I only heard when Sir Lyndon called for me when I signed a contract at the Radisson Hotel. And he said, come and see me. I said, Lord, I start shaking, because I never met him personally except at Carnival. And he said, I want you to bring a contract. And he looked at it, and he said, I have to make sure that you're not fronting for anybody. This is Bahamian time. And I believe that that is the philosophy and the spirit when we look at greats like Sir Franklin Wilson and yes. The Sunshine Boys. Yes. They are a group of entrepreneurs and so many who we should be proud of as Bahamians because of the policies that facilitated ownership for Bahamians.
We have others who have expressed their love for Sir Lyndon and reflected on his life. Please, let us watch.
I think it was easy for him because he was married and his wife realized that he was in charge and that she had a responsibility to take care of the family, even though she was involved. She knew at that point she will have to take care of the family. But not only that, I recognized that even though he was prime minister, he went home every day for lunch. He never ate out lunchtime. So that alone was saying, I can go home and have lunch with my family. And I also realized that the lunch he went home for, most of the time was cooked by his wife. So that alone made her feel happy to know her husband was coming home for lunch at a certain time and that she could have it prepared. And whether you believe it or not, one day I had lunch with them. And it was interesting. It was peas and grits. And he ate the fish head. A regular man. Regular Bahamian man, I should call it. And that's how he was.
Well, when one is called for a particular vocation in life, then things will fall in place. Yes, he was a young husband and father of children, but when you have a wife at home that is able to, like you say, take up the slack, then things work together for good.
Sir Lyndon's real strengths included the fact that he loved a remarkable woman in Marguerite Pindling. And that love he had for her and what she showed to him just took him from good to great. I think history needs to understand I don't think it's possible to understand Pindling's greatness without also seeing the greatness of that dear Marguerite.
What I know, there is a balance, but one thing I can say is that he could not do it alone. Balancing family life in respect to persons involved in politics do require an understanding family, an understanding spouse, and someone who understands that when you go home, you want to leave behind the troubles of this political life and be home and find solace at home. And I think he found that in Lady Pindling. And I think the balance really, what I call the hems person at the wheel to ensure balance was Lady Pindling.
Sir Lyndon Pindling is an exemplar on how to balance family life with politics. He never compromised on going home every day for lunch. And he would go home, and at the end of his lunch, he would have a nap, and he would come back. And if we were meeting in cabinet, we knew exactly what he was doing. He would come back refreshed, renewed. But it was something that he took a lot of pains to ensure he never compromised on. He had a wife who truly understood his role, his aspirations, and really what was necessary for her in giving support. And so in Dame Marguerite, Sir Lyndon had a fierce partner who was able to ensure that what he wanted to do with respect to family life, that is, to give his wife an opportunity to fellowship with him during a day and to have his children, as they were born and growing up, to be a part of that process. I thought he did a wonderful job at that and really, truly set a wonderful example.
Dame Marguerite said once that Sir Lyndon must always have a home to come home to. After all that's happened all day, he must be able to come home. And so she always wanted to be peaceful, have all that the Prime Minister wanted, her husband, the father of her children. And we must remember the work she did in this country, the Red Cross Society. And nothing has happened as she did since. And you, Debbie, was assigned to cover Dame Marguerite as she traveled throughout the Commonwealth of the Bahamas.
I just want to publicly thank Dame Marguerite, you are an exceptional human being. I have had the opportunity to travel throughout Berlin. Come on, give it a little louder here. I saw Minister Wilschkamp, Dame Marguerite, go into Andros and sit on a rock by the stove and just eat out of whatever they gave. And I was right there, I'm not hungry, I'm fasting. I said, oh Lord.
Need prayers.
But you know, after a while, I had to follow Dame Marguerite. Take a little something from the stomach, but it was good. But also, I think one of the tremendous experiences with the Pindling family, as our Prime Minister indicated, of how important the family is they believed in family, but they are also great with hospitality. And they were able to make everyone feel that there was an invisible sign on us that says you are important too. Mm-hmm.
And you heard so often that he would be with kings and queens, but you never, and he never did, and they never did. They never lost a common touch. And that's what's critical here, because when Dame Marguerite traveled the country for Red Cross, we might not have understood the purpose and the work that she was doing at the time. And frankly, it was a real big assignment. But what she was doing is raising money for those poor people, those individuals who don't have, and those individuals who were homeless, and those individuals who might have a difficulty. But she was out there doing it, sitting on Bay Street when they were selling the tickets, making sure that people could buy tickets. And she did it, and your personality, you gave it the brand, and you made it what it was, and you made Red Cross so successful and helped our country, particularly after 1979 when Sir Lyndon launched the social revolution. And you remember that when he did, because it was on the visit of Pope John Paul II, and what he did was he went to convention, and he said, we shall launch the social revolution. We shall heal the sick, feed the poor, guide the youth, bring peace to every heart. That was 1979. And that is why Sir Lyndon said, when you asked him, how do you want to be remembered? He wants to be remembered by creating the safety net for the Bahamian people. That he thought was the most important thing he did. National insurance. That's the most important thing he did for the Bahamian people.
As I reflect, Dame Marguerite made the Red Cross and the annual Red Cross Fair, as Sir Lyndon did for the carnival, the two most important events in the Bahamas. But I recall being awakened early one morning because a single mother did not have food for a few days and came home from work, and she ran down to the bridge to get some fish. And she left her kids in their home. They did not have electricity, and the lantern fell over, and all of the kids burned in that house. I don't know if you remember Dame Marguerite, but early in the morning, she mobilized the entire media, and she mobilized corporate sponsors, and she facilitated that grieving mother to get back on her feet with shelter, with food, and with provision.
They always reached out. In 1992, Debbie, we were in the midst of the general elections campaign. It wasn't the best campaign for the PLP, but, you know, we were... didn't feel good. But I remember when Sir Lyndon was at a school in Abaco, and he received a phone call, and the call came from the Olympics that Frank Rutherford had won the bronze medal. And Sir Lyndon was so excited, it changed the entire day. And he felt that that was one of the biggest accomplishments of our country. He said Frank Rutherford had won, and he celebrated. And it's the same way he did for a young girl named Vanita Rowe. He called on a Friday afternoon. He said, what are you doing? I said, nothing, sir. He said, wheels up 1 o'clock. We thought we were going to Andros. But he wasn't going to Andros. He was going to Long Island. He had purchased a pair of sprints for this girl who he saw run without shoes. And he flew to Long Island and then got in the vehicle, got to the school. Nobody knew he was coming. And he went looking for this little girl to give her the pair of shoes. She went on to become a track and field champion. She would eventually die of cancer. But again, it's what he did to help. And he didn't make much about it. Just cared so much about the behavior of people.
I don't hear a lot of talk about the impact Sir Lyndon has had on the international community. And I remember that in 1985, during the Nassau Accord, I was a reporter watching and just always engrossed in what was happening in South Africa. And it was a very special moment in time as CHOGM held and hosted its meeting here in the Bahamas. You were the news director there and assigned to Sir Lyndon. And do we, Minister, think that the people of the Bahamas widely know the impact that he has made in mobilizing the world to impose sanctions, and which eventually led to the dismantlement of apartheid?
I think over time, our people would understand it better. And 2 years will mark the 30th anniversary since Nelson Mandela was freed. It started here. And Sir Lyndon was able to get the Commonwealth, even though Margaret Thatcher, the then Prime Minister of Great Britain, did not support economic sanctions, he was able to get the African countries and other countries to agree. In fact, it was a very difficult time because you had people like Robert Mugabe saying that Britain no longer runs the Commonwealth. They took very strong positions. The Prime Minister, Rajiv Gandhi of India, left the conference because he did not like the decision made by Great Britain. And so they compromised. They agreed to an eminent persons group, and the eminent persons group would meet and over a three-month period determine whether or not efforts were being made by South Africa to end apartheid. Well, they met in London, and the eminent persons group said there was no change. And so there was a subsequent meeting in Canada, Toronto, Canada. I remember it very well. And if you ever get a chance to read Brian Mulroney's book, Brian Mulroney tells the story of how Sir Lyndon showed him what diplomacy is all about. Because Sir Lyndon had to go to room to room to room to room and talk to all the leaders and get them to stay within the Commonwealth as you work it out. And he eventually got them to agree. Britain would eventually agree. So Lyndon would then jump on the plane and go to Chicago, invited by Jesse Jackson. And he delivered, Dame Margaret, you were there, when he delivered that wonderful speech, I've come to look for America. It was a speech that turned the entire world around. Sanctions were implemented, the sanctions against South Africa. Nelson Mandela was freed, and Nelson Mandela's first visit was to Jamaica, and eventually came to the Bahamas, and he wanted to spend time with Sir Lyndon Pindling. You hosted him at your residence. But what I remember about his first speech here was the night at Balmoral Beach Hotel, when the then Prime Minister was Hubert Ingraham, and he was to welcome Nelson Mandela. But he stepped aside, and he allowed Sir Lyndon to do it. He said, Sir Lyndon, you were responsible. He allowed Sir Lyndon to welcome him. I thought that was one of the greatest moments in our country because he could have taken and decided he didn't want to. He allowed Sir Lyndon to do it. It was a fantastic evening. I still have tapes of these because they're so important and it was so significant. And then you heard this humble man tell the story of how he didn't know Nelson Mandela. And the first time you heard the story was from Loftus Roca, who told him about Nelson Mandela and his difficulties. But Sir Lyndon not only changed our country, He was also the prime minister who recommended that we have the University of the West Indies throughout the region. And he then impacted the world. So he was more than the leader of the Bahamas. He was the leader of the world.
Minister, I think that's a great place to end, and we'll quote Miss Laura. He had plenty intelligence. We're going to have a powerful son of the Bahamas who has made his mark internationally as we invite Mr. Nehemiah Hill to pay tribute to the father of our nation.
Good evening, everybody.
It's been a long, long time coming, but I know change is gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. Say, brother, help me, please. But he winds up knocking me, yeah. Knocking me back down on my knees. I go to the and I go downtown. Somebody keeps telling me, don't hang around. It's been a long, long time coming, but I know a change is gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Change is gonna come. Why, yes, it will, yeah. It's been a long time coming. I just want all of you to know that I am one of those young men living the dream that Sir Lyndon had back then. Yes! Yes! A change is gonna come. That's what he did. Yes! It's been a long time coming. But we're living in the dream. We're living in the change is here, Bohemians.
A country where every Bohemian stands tall, independent and free. A country where there is opportunity for all. A secure future for each soul, bold enough to grasp it. A land where excellence is cherished and hard work is a thing of pride. A nation disciplined and strong. To those who share a similar vision, I say step now, our finest warriors forward. Amazons of vision, fighters of courage, warriors of steel. No weak hearts, no half-steppers, no weaklings. We want those who do not shrink from dirty hands, those with the imagination to create, persons with the strength of character to stare into the chilly teeth of the raging winds of change, soldiers without fail, for we are setting out on a new journey to a new frontier. Those strong enough to journey beyond the blazing sunset, tough enough to battle for the victory beyond the far horizon, and brave enough to claim the new frontier, will be able to say, like the psalmist did, we were glad when they said unto us, let us go into the house of the Lord.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, please stand and give a rousing round of applause as we now invite Dame Marguerite Pindling and her family to the stage. Can I hear a round of applause? And what about another round of applause? As they settle in.
Come on, let's give another round of applause. The Honorable Minister is going to leave us a do. Give him a little round of applause there. He did a phenomenal job. And we have all of our flags I don't know where mine went. Let's wave it just for a moment because we have the greatest little country in the world. Come on, come on. Do you all believe that? When Bahamians arrive, first class has arrived. One more round of applause for the mother of our country and our family. Come on, let them feel our love. Okay, now you can clap. This is such an honor for me. I have not interviewed the mother of our nation for many years. She is aging gracefully, and anytime she stood next to the Queen of England, we could say we have our Queen of the Bahamas. Dame Marguerite, you have done our country so proud, and we see you, but I would like to begin with the children, because we have not seen them a lot, or some of them, especially Leslie over there. But I remember this family growing up in Soldier Road. And did you know that Obie Pindling was playing the bass from then, and I was trying to play the guitar, and played, in case y'all didn't believe me, and played in the group called the Soul Intimidators, but they didn't keep me there very long. But he has become one of the most accomplished musicians and attorneys in the country. Give him a round of applause. My friend, I don't know why he dropped me, Leslie, him and Monique, we used to be all around town, and there is something that has remained constant, and that is they have the common touch, they are humble, and really love to stay behind the scenes. Please welcome Mr. Leslie Pindling, an entrepreneur.
Okay, that was a side joke there.
I can't see down there, but it's something. And of course, finally, we most of us know the youngest, who is again an entrepreneur and always a friend of the reporters at the Broadcasting Corporation of the Bahamas. Please welcome extraordinary entrepreneur, Monique Pindling.
Thank you.
Please welcome. I want to start with Monique to talk a little bit about what was it like living with the father and mother of our nation. We see a lot of the public profile. And what is it that you would like us to know about your daddy and our father of the nation?
You hit on it earlier this evening, and I had just said it to Leslie before the ceremony had begun. Mm-hmm. This is the first time that the family has ever been involved in a Q&A kind of thing, speaking about our experience with our parents. Nobody really asked us. So to answer your question, my experience and time with Daddy is a little different than Michelle Obi and Leslie, because I came at Soldier Road, but after Soldier Road. But it was ordinary. I know people wouldn't believe it, but it was very ordinary. Daddy wouldn't have it any other way. We did ordinary things. We played, we hung out, roller skates, bicycle, chopper bicycles. Obi was always playing music in the house, so we would join him, and I learned how to play the bass guitar. Leslie was playing the drums. So there was always a mini kind of band going on inside the house somewhere. Mummy was very strict.
What?
but what does that mean? You couldn't date? What?
Well,
was.
I was born in 67. So when I came around, everything was just different. And all I can tell people today, now having children of my daughters of my own, I see now why she used to say what she said so many times. That back then, even now raising my two daughters, her voice is in my head. Daddy had a job, a really important job. And she used to say they're gonna get to him through you. And you can't do this and you can't do that, and you have to act because whatever you do, it's gonna reflect on your father. And somehow all four of us, let me speak for myself, that was ingrained in us. And so we tried, I mean, we did everything we could to make him proud, to not get in trouble as best as we could. All four of us, I think, had a love for him and a respect for him. He was cool Modi. That's what I used to call him. He was the coolest dude you could ever meet. And I say,
why would you?
Because Daddy would let you do what you, he would let you just live your life. He would let you, whatever dream you had, with any, whatever vision you had, whatever you wanted to try, he would let you try. Because he believed that if you tried it, you would be good at something. And he wanted us to live our own lives, because around the dinner table, he would say to Mommy eventually, at some point, this is his job. This is his life. He didn't want it for the four of us. He wanted us to have regular, simple lives, separate and apart from his life. And that's why the four of us could live the way we live, very normally, very regularly. And it doesn't faze us. It doesn't bother us. But it was difficult. Most people don't realize how difficult it was for me growing up. I didn't have parents, really. They were never home. They were always in and out.
How did you manage that coming up? Did you feel alone?
Yes, but I had Rosemary, I had Joyce. I had you, I had Obi. Because I was always traveling with them, but y'all were always my company.
Yes.
I don't know if I ever felt alone or lonely. I knew they were busy and I knew that they had something to do. But he always took us with him, always in Andros. Every regatta we went to, we were in every island. We were always in Andros. Andros was our second home. So even though he wasn't there, he was there. And I don't think I can tell you at this age now, no regrets. It was just difficult. People have no idea how difficult it was for the four of us. Watching and seeing them work so hard. And then sometimes it was good, and then sometimes it was bad. And all four of us, I think I could say, it used to hurt all of us. You know, because we were so proud of our parents, then and still now. You could ask them.
I was just about to move across to Obi. It was difficult. I want you to answer those two questions. Who was your father that you would want us to know? But sometimes we see the glitz and the glamour. We see the outriders and, you know, and it looks like, oh, this is the life that I would want. And then there's the criticism in the press. And there's the pain. And a lot of people perhaps don't think about the pain that you endure as well. Speak to that, both Obi and Leslie, please.
Well, you started by saying, who was he as a father? And Monique touched on it. And, you know, with him being in public life and being prime minister for so long, as children, you get to understand and appreciate a lot of the foolishness that's out there and the false rumors and the stories. And I'm not talking about political stuff. I'm talking about just general life. And as Monique said, Daddy allowed us to be who we wanted to be. I remember when I came home from law school, I was only 21. And as you alluded to, I'd been playing music all my life. And by the way, we didn't put you out the band. You left to form your own band. And a lot of people don't know that Debbie Ashley was a recording artist and had a song that she recorded with her band playing on Zed Ness. So let's get that part straight.
Let me know the secrets.
Yes. But anyway, and I remember coming back from school, and six months later, I decided to get back into music and put a band together. Then the band started to grow and get popular. And then the story started. Oh, I didn't want to be no lawyer. I only was a lawyer because my daddy wanted me to be a lawyer. I really wanted to be a musician. And that was so far from the truth. You know, a lot of people don't know that my dad himself was a musician. Dad used to do piano recitals in Savannah Sound, Eleuthera, when he was a boy as a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
People don't know that,
but daddy was a musician. And he was excited that I was playing music, and he was happy that I was playing music. And I always remember, well, first of all, I know a lot of you people are not going to believe this, but I'm a person who never used to like soca. And daddy kept inviting me to go to carnival with him every time he went, and I was never interested. And I went to a Byron Lee show at Paradise Island on Christmas of 95. And when we were having lunch the next, I said, boy, Daddy, I couldn't believe that music I was hearing. It was so great. He said, well, if you heard that, that's a joke. You need to come to Trinidad and hear it in its real form. And that's when I went with him for the first time in 1986. And I was so amazed and enthralled by the music. That's why I haven't missed a carnival since then. But he was the one who introduced me to carnival and to soca, you know. And he was always supportive of the music. And then after a few years we started, he said, you know, your band really sounds good, but if you want your band to be the best it could be, you need to put some brass in it, put horns in the band. So we always used to laugh when we used to hear those stories about him never wanting me to play music, and he wanted me to be a lawyer. And I enjoyed being a lawyer. As a matter of fact, I wanted to be a lawyer because he was a lawyer. And you know, most young fellas want to be like their daddy. I don't want no politics, but y'all know that. But I wanted to be in there, and I used to watch the television programs on Perry Mason on TV during the 60s as a boy. But he encouraged the music. And getting to the part you're talking about, the pain, over the years, and we've had, you know, several prime ministers now and different generations of politicians, and I laugh to myself when we hear in today's political era people talking, but y'all don't realize people have families, and y'all saying these, and we laughed, where was this sentiment back when we were children? You know, and one of the reasons why I despise politics is because of the personal attacks. I was walking in, and my good friend there, Adrian White, when we were coming in tonight, and we were talking about this very thing, you know. And because Daddy was Prime Minister when we were so young, there were a number of things that happened that kind of traumatized me and turned me off from, you know, even wanting to consider politics. And I'm not saying these things to be political. I'm just saying these things to let you know what we experienced as children. I'll never forget the election campaign of 1972. And independence was the main thrust of the campaign of the PLP at the time. And the party had a rally in Marsh Harbor, Abaco, scheduled. And like I said, I'll never forget this. I had a cat boy right here on my leg. And mommy sent me outside to get two leaves from the pepper tree. And she was warming up some Jamaica healing oil to put on the boil and to put the pepper leaf on. Y'all young people probably wondering what the hell we'll be talking about. But that used to cure the cat boils. And as I walked back inside, mommy was on the phone in tears. And I said, well, mommy, what happened? I'm 13 years old now. Mommy, what happened? She was on the phone. Charles Carter had called mommy to tell mommy. Well, let me lay the story first. The rally was supposed to have been on the government dock. Clearly, God had intervened, and the party had relocated the rally to the park in Marsh Harbor. And I don't remember the exact time, but it was around 9 or so. Dynamite blew up the government dock. And she was in tears, and she said, those people tried to kill your daddy. And I remember crying. I said, but for what? because of difference of political opinion. And that was one of the first traumatic experiences in my life to cause me to despise politics. And there were many others after that, but the other major one was in 1983, September, when NBC had that story about him taking drug money from Joe Leader to allow his drugs to run through the Bahamas. And I'm saying to myself, this is the extent that people will go to try to destroy you just to get elected? And there's a whole history behind that. And I don't have to say anything because all you have to do is watch the DVD movie that Calvin Harris did. What's it called? And Sir Arthur Folks spoke very eloquently. He didn't speak directly, but he spoke very eloquently to give an explanation as to what really was going on at that time and where that whole thing came from. And I said to myself, there's no way in my life, when I have my own children and my own family, will I ever subject, you know, my family to this kind of abuse, because it's just not worth it. And I have many friends in the political spectrum on all sides, and we speak very openly and frankly about this stuff, but I don't know when it's going to stop, but I hope and pray that as a nation, and you young people who are in the audience, and you young people become the political leaders of the country of the future, that you advance your political agenda on the issues, and let's get the personal attacks out of it, because every prime minister, every deputy prime minister, every minister, every cabinet, every member of parliament, they have families. And most of them have families with young children. And people don't understand. But yes, actually, Bahamian people do understand. Because if you're in school and somebody says something about your ma or pa, they fighting words. So I don't know why it's so difficult to understand. It would continue to hurt children who have parents in the political arena and in the public exposure to not be hurt when they say these things about your father or your mother. But, you know, as far as it, you know, and people always used to say, how could you all be the children of the prime minister and you all have pain and you all suffering and whatever? People don't understand, you know. And one thing, well, there were several things that Daddy always instilled in us. But one thing he always used to say, even to Mommy when, you know, we're having lunch and she's rowing, you all see Mommy still rowing over Daddy today. Okay? Daddy's been there now 23 years and she's still rowing to defend him today. You know? But when we would go home and we would have lunch and Daddy would say things, and Daddy would say, that's why there's only one prime minister in this house and it ain't you. That's why I have and you're not. That's right. And he used to tell us, because he is prime minister, he don't want us to expect no special treatment from nobody. You always be respectful to people. You always, yes sir, no ma'am, wherever you go, if there's a line, you stand in the line. And you ain't no different to everybody else. You're no different to everybody else. And I remember Obi Wilscombe alluded to the 1992 campaign, and I remember 1992 when we lost. A very close friend of mine who was F&M, she called me the next morning. She said, I just called in to see how you're doing. You all right? I said, of course I'm all right. Why shouldn't I be all right? She said, well, I thought you would be miserable. I said, I'm to work. Of course, I'm disappointed, but we didn't win. But politics isn't life. And you know, Daddy being prime minister was never anything for us to look at as something that we would benefit from or whatever. Him winning and losing, he was still just Daddy. And that was the most important thing, and he instilled that in us every day.
You know, just before we go on to Leslie, I must say that, you know, the mark of a great leader, Minister Wilscombe and I, you know, by that time I was a little promoted, I could go to the big assignments with the Prime Minister, and we were in Andros in the 1992. And when he received, we were there with Dame Marguerite and Sir Lyndon, the people have spoken. just calm, went to speak to the radio audience from Andros to the Bahamas, just a statesman. But I think it is so important that both you and Monique, and I know now Leslie, is opening up, because I do not get a sense, being a public figure more in the past than now, that people understand that when you attack a person, you are touching the entire family.
That's right. That's right.
And nobody asked before. And say it again?
Nobody ever asked before. Nobody ever asked the four of us how we were doing. Not once. Nobody ever said, how are you all doing today? When all of the kerfuffle was going on, nobody said, Marguerite, how are you doing today? Michelle, Obi, Monique, how you all do? Not one person. But yet again, they'll go around and they'll talk and talk and say all kind of things and just expect us to smile. So, you know, there's a good side and then there's a bad side.
Which begs a question. I still feel that there's a sense of pain.
Oh, no.
No?
No, no.
You're over it?
Oh, I ain't gonna lie. Yes, I still love it, yeah.
Yeah. Leslie.
I don't know why you're laughing. It's just real. It's the truth. No. Mm-hmm. But I was always the one who couldn't. I was the one who could take it the least, anyway.
Right.
You know, I wasn't able to handle it the way Leslie.
And some of us are more resilient than others. And so, Monique is saying she's fine. She's healed. We're gonna hear what Leslie says now. But thank you, Obi, for your honesty. But Leslie.
Got ulcers. He got ulcers because of it.
Mm-hmm. I didn't hear you.
Obi got ulcers because of it and has bad stomach
IBS.
Because of all the pain he's endured.
About that.
Yeah, just worrying, yes.
Yeah.
But Leslie, speak to who was your dad and what would you like us to remember? We are talking about that.
Can I say
yes,
Dave. Sir Lyden. First of all, could I recognize the people in the audience?
Yes, you
just... Someone came up here and spoke about the frying fish and eating the fish. Placey down there somewhere.
Placey right
did lunch for us one time and sent a plate of fried snappers without the heads. And Sir Lyden just asked, well, what happened to the snapper heads? And that's what I came home for, to eat my fish head. And thank you, Felix Bow, for coming, and Charlie Major. I haven't seen you all in ages, but, you know, it's a good thing to bring us all together tonight. And it's bringing back some pleasant memories, some unpleasant ones. But Sir Lyden was a strong man, and he never allowed what happened out there to interfere with his home. He left that out there because I wouldn't allow it. Don't bring the problems. Leave the problems to the cabinet office. But when you come to Long Bay or wherever else we were living, that was home. That's where love abided. And plenty of love with us. Okay, listen. You may carry on. We haven't heard from you yet.
The question again, Debbie, is?
Yeah. I want you to answer two questions. But just before you go, let's give the High Commissioner a round of applause. You said nobody ever asked you.
No.
They facilitated this. I think they deserve a round of applause.
I did tell her.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, but who is the father that you would like us to know?
Very easygoing, but very stern. He gave you chances until you messed up, and then he became a very stern person. Allowed you to do and go wherever you wanted to, but you always had to follow the rules. Great fisherman. Love that. Great boatsman.
What kind of fish is he catch?
He'll catch anything. If you give him a line and conch, he'll do that. He'll go deep sea fishing. He'll dive. He was scuba. One of the things when he and Pierre Trudeau went to a meeting, and I think they got together in the back and everybody was waiting in the meeting, him and Pierre Trudeau went on, they went scuba diving and left everybody there. He loved his Bahamas. That's what I must tell everybody. If My Bahamian people love this country the way my daddy did. My God. And he was nice.
What are the highlights of your experience with your father, the Prime Minister, and the challenges that you... Were you grieved as well as Monique and Obi?
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
What were the difficult moments for you?
I went to boarding school because I had a difficult moment.
I didn't hear you. I didn't hear you last week.
I'm a little volatile.
Watching him, I think. Watching the concern that it's...
See, Obi won't do anything. I won't. I'm a McKenzie.
He's a McKenzie.
Watching the wear and tear on both Mommy and Daddy was, I think, the four of us. We took that on because we actually saw... you know, just the pace. You could ask the Prime Minister, Christie, Minnis, Davis, the pace at which they have to go every single day. That's a lot on a person. And from 7 o'clock in the morning till 7 o'clock in the morning, it's nonstop. People calling, wanting something every second of the day. You don't get a moment. And you could see as a child, as a spouse, you could see the physical, mental wear and tear. And you get up and say you want to take a break. They can ask you why you want to take a break. Someone down the road needs you here. Someone needs you. It's taxing. And as a child, children, watching him go at the pace he did, and then watching Mummy just chiming in there, fighting the battle, the good fight with him. You know, we were proud of our parents, but we knew that they worked hard, but they instilled in all of us. That's why I think, even though Obi says he's not political, he doesn't like politics. Boy, you can't beat Obi at politics. You can't beat any of us at politics.
What hurt the most, Eddie, was when my friends let my daddy down, when his friends let him
disappear.
Abandoned him. Because they're supposed to be your friends.
You don't let him down.
Many friends today.
You mean let him down after 1992 or throughout the...
Progressionally.
Throughout.
Yeah.
It doesn't all come at once.
But anyway.
And that's why...
Yes.
That's why Mummy said don't keep no company. And we're still a strong little, very intimate family. We go very few places. We always have Sunday lunch together.
Still.
With all the husbands, wives, all the children, grandchildren.
Still today.
Every Sunday, as a family, as Daddy would have wanted.
Dame Marguerite, that is something very special because the whole Bahamas knew that Sir Lyndon came home. And I want to stay there just for a moment on family and the example that you set. Because we look at Wendy's lines, and I say, when we were growing up, we didn't go to Wendy's on Sunday. And the restaurants, and when there were certain sacred days when we did not go out to dinner. We had dinner at home, like we had lunch at home. Speak to what that was like to you and Sir Lyndon as parents who are parents of a nation and parents of four children. Is there a way you can describe what you were trying to do in that balance at home and in nation?
If I could just go back a bit and say that early in our marriage, I think it was the first week, the first Sunday after we came back to Nassau, he was on his way out. 1 week after marriage. And I said, well, where are you going? And he just said to me very politely in a cool manner, I don't have the time to explain to you what I'm doing. If you want to know, you have to follow me. And boy, I've been following ever since. It was the only way for me to learn what he was about. And this isn't something that he could have explained. I had to see it and feel it for myself.
But getting back to his coming home every day for lunch, I had my social calendar, but I arranged that so that I could be at home when he came in for lunch. I had a cook who thought of it. You come and tidy yourself. Your husband is on his way. Meet him to the door. She would walk me to the door, and you stay here, and you wait and receive him in, and you see him out every day. And I made sure that the kitchen was in order, and we cooked only Bahamian dishes at our home, which we still do to this day. All that fancy stuff, you have that when you eat away from home at restaurants. But he came home because the food was tasty and sweet.
Did you cook?
Sometimes I did. But I put extra love into that. I made sure. But to tell you why he came every day for lunch is because we had so little time together. And that 1 hour he came for lunch, I had to be there to hear what was happening in order for me to keep abreast as to what he was doing. Because he was a man of few words. You ask him a question, you got an answer. And you'd be standing there waiting for one. He says, yes. You know how Mama said, what else? You want some milk? Right. And that is why he said, if you want to know what I'm doing, you have to follow. And I learned over the years that he was strong, determined, charismatic, gentle. And first of all, Lyden Pindling was a Christian. I learned that at Johns Hopkins in 1996 when he was taking his treatment there. I said, you know, thank you, Jesus. That's why he was able to achieve the things he has achieved. God was with him, he and his men. But when he said that, I said, I want to take him back to St. Agnes. He says, no, I am going back to my own church. And I don't know how many ladies and gentlemen in the audience could go way back in the early days when children, young men, used to wear their trousers buttoned onto the shirt. The buttons used to be on the shirt, and the buttonhole on the trousers. Well, don't be sophisticated, because that's where we came from. It was Pindling who brought us an AD. We haven't spoken about AD tonight. I saw AD out there healing. But the thing was, that's the way it was in the early days before the PLP came along and opened our eyes to a better way of life. And when he said he was going back to his own church, I said, his mother trained him at an early age. And he remembered from his early years to whatever age he was in 1996 that he wanted to go back to his church.
That's phenomenal. Let's give a round of applause for that.
And that is why he was able to do the things. That was why he was able to do the things that he did. That is why he was able to accomplish so many things, because he put God first.
Obi was trying to get in a little word there.
Yeah, because two things when we said that job, certain memories. She said she asked Daddy one time where he was going, and he was saying, if you want to know, you got to come and follow. That wasn't always the case, because I remember specifically one time we were living in Soldier Road, and Clarence Bain and I think Mr. David Clare and a couple other Central Andrews fellas were there, and Mr. Bain came to the house and said, come, let's go. And so Mommy said, well, where y'all going? And Mr. Bain said, keep out of my business. And they were going to Central Andrews to do whatever political business they were doing. But Mommy mentioned Mr. Hannah, and I remember Obi Wilstra mentioned earlier on Successor and their relationship. And Glennis, I'm sure you remember this. Every Sunday, Mommy would take us to visit different wives. But most of the time, we would go and visit the Hannahs out in South Beach and Mrs. Wallace Whitfield, who was on Soldier Road. And, you know, Daddy always got all the glory. But I always said, every time I speak publicly, yes, he was the leader, but he wouldn't have been the man he was without the team that he had. And I was just telling this story to a young lawyer in Freeport. People don't understand the role, especially the younger, don't understand the role that the women in the PLP played.
And y'all, just a minute. Y'all see Glennis right there, how fiery she is? People think she takes after her father. Her mother was the fireball. Okay, and we would go and visit on Sundays. We would go and visit on Sundays, and Mommy and Mrs. Hannah would be talking PLP talk and stuff, and the rest of us, we would just be sitting there listening. And these women, it was just amazing to see.
Glennis,
but the women were so supportive. Not only the wives, but the women of the country, and the women getting the right to vote in 1962. And the women, Glennis, you remember the curry goat parties and the curry days, they'd be cooking the food to raise the money for the parties? The women who really helped bring the PLP to office in 1967, and without the women, they wouldn't have won. But Daddy always followed instructions. I remember hearing again one of the rumors that he was a dictator and always wanted his own way. Not a thing like it. As a matter of fact, Glennis, there's another story about your daddy as well. And he tell it, no, Chief, it ain't going that way. We can do it this way. And he listened to his, it was a team.
Yep.
Yes, he got the glory, and yes, the PLP this and the PLP did that, but the PLP was a daddy and his team. Okay? And without the team and without the women, he would never have accomplished what he would have done.
We talked about the late Sir Cecil Wallace Whitfield and the late A.D. Hannah. And they are leaders who started together. And you went and visited. Dame Marguerite had you go and visit. And then they separated with different political views. But somehow, the politicians of the day were able to have the maturity. They break up in politics, but they're still friends. But we don't seem to have done that really well. As a people, you all agree?
Yes.
Yes. Dame Marguerite. Leslie, we let our matriarch, and then I'm going to come right to you right after
you
Dame Marguerite.
Back to that.
Oh, he's insisting I yield to your son, huh?
When Daddy was on his deathbed, Norman Solomon
called me.
And say he wanted to come and see his friend.
And so did Mr. Ingram.
Called me. Yes.
And asked if what he was hearing was true. And asked if he could go because he would like to go and see him. And when Mr. Ingram came, he wept like a baby.
So did Mr. Solomon.
That's right.
That friendship you talk about, that
they were political adversaries,
yes,
but they were friends.
But respectful as friends.
That's the key to what you just asked.
Yes.
Friendship. Yes.
Friendship.
Yes. Yes.
Today we don't have that friendship.
And respect for one another.
The original team of the Progressive Liberal Party, they were scholars together. They were scholars. Government High School. They all wanted the same thing for the Bahamas. Some wanted it faster than others. But I started to say that, of course, that's gone out of my head now. But they were, every Saturday afternoon we were down in Howard Street, Chippingham, at Cecil and Beverly's home, eating sausage and crackers, playing Scrabble. That's the only game I play. I don't know any other game. But they would come to our home, we would go to their homes, but outside they were friends. Because, like I said, they all wanted the same things for their Bahamas, only at different times, different places, in different ways. But Sir Lyndon was an obedient person, and if Minky's in this house tonight, I'm sure and Glennis Hannah could acknowledge it, that Sir Lyndon was, even though he was the leader of this party, he was the most humble person I know. And he would follow instructions, and Dad Maynard would tell him, PM, you ain't going there today, you're going there tomorrow. This is your schedule. And not a word, he would just obey whatever he had to do, and he went. It was teamwork, and like I said, plenty love in the Progressive Liberal Party. Not one person in our party ever moved, especially the women, never moved unless the other knew, because we were headed in the same direction for the same cause. There was no this group and that group. The women would not have had it. Glennis, if your mama was here tonight, she would agree with me. One night, she and I went out, and I don't think I was able to drive then. We were driving this Volkswagen, not paying attention to what we were doing, running into the wall of
Algernon Allen's father's business. And when he came outside and saw, he said, "Oh, that's Yena. Otherwise, I'll make you pay for my wall." But it was just the funniest thing, that the wonderful times we used to have together. But getting back to my husband coming home for lunch every day, we had so little time together. And so the 1 hour that he was able to spare to come home to catch up on what was going on in the family, but how the children were doing, and of course, like I said, to enjoy a Bahamian cooked meal, was very important. He knew how important it was to me because we saw so little of each other. You have no idea the sacrifices that were made. My PLP family are friends in this room tonight. Let me tell you something. My children had no father. I was mother and father for them because he was always away from home. And I always said, you know, I must have taken after my mother in Andros because she had, the way she went about doing things, she never grumbled. I never heard him grumble. I never heard her grumbling about my father not being at home with her raising the children by herself. And so I must have inherited some of that because I believed in what he was doing. I enjoyed what he was doing. It was exciting in those days because, like I said, we were all friends then. And this is how I got to know the little extra that was happening outside. And he knew that he couldn't bring his problems in his home because I would not have had it, because that was his sanctuary. And that was the only place we had that we could call home and we could be a family and sit down and relax for a few minutes. He would come and have his, and let me tell you something, my children. He used to come to a fancy table. Crystals and china and whatever, you name it. Plus coconut water. And sometimes he'd ring up and said, "I want you to put another place setting because I have a gift with me." I said, "Well, suppose I don't have enough." He said, "Make it enough." But this is how this, and Felix, you could attest to this. You and Charlie Major could attest, you know I'm telling you the truth. That he would come so that he could rest a while, take a nap for 15 minutes, believe it or not, and after 15 minutes, he's out the door. And then he would come home in the evenings. It was only time we had 15 minutes together for supper. We will chat a few minutes. Then he's back to work. He never seemed to have had time to waste. He was always writing and tearing newspapers and clipping out and putting aside and sorting out. And by this time, I'm just standing, watching. And I said, "Lord, I just pray for him. Just keep him safe. Keep him strong." And that dynamite in Abaco, let me tell you something. When I heard Charles Carter say, "Oh, my God, an explosion just went up on the dock where Pindling is speaking." And then after that, my doorbell rang. And the angels from Bethel Baptist Church came through the door with the prayers. Mother Rand and Reverend Harriet MacDonald and her praying group. "Miss Pindling, we just heard what happened. Come, let's pray to pray for Sir Lyndon's safety." And then right after that, he called and said, "I just want to let you know I'm all right." Then I was able to breathe again. But it was a difficult period, but it was worth it all because this is what he wanted for his Bahamas, and I had to support him because he had no siblings, so I had to be his arm and leg and ears and eyes and whatever. Otherwise, I'll go on all evening.
Yes.
You know, this is really historic. We're getting so much rich information. We have one more question. I can't help but think that we talk about the team. I like that. You can't do anything without a team. But we had Christy Ingram Davis and Co. Now, the father was the mentor. One of them went another way. But doesn't it speak to mentorship and leadership? And I believe that when we look at all of the prime ministers, we are still the third strongest economy in the Western Hemisphere. We have a strong foundation. So we're out of time, but I think it is worth just giving your perspective of what is it that Sir Lyndon saw? What is it that he wanted? Are we in that direction? going in the direction to being the greatest little country in the world. Dame Margaret.
Oh, he just wanted the best for his people. He just wanted... Hallelujah.
He did. To all of the school children out there, I think he would look at you and say that all of you boys and girls, it's time to get serious. It's time to work hard. Because he kept talking about this dream of hope, this dream of opportunity. Well, when are you going to dream? When are you going to have that hope that you could move from this spot to that spot? You have to see the place where you want to be, and you have to try and get there. And I think he would want all the children now, okay, it's all the play time is over now. I think we've missed the mark here on schoolwork and grades, because there will be no Bahamas tomorrow if our next generation isn't ready and prepared.
Leslie.
Education was key. Slunking was not allowed. Go to school and do what you're supposed to do. And the children of Bahamas, when we went to Holly's graduation, this young girl who went to the Eleuthera school came to meet Mummy. She was studying molecular biology. This little 17-year-old, she got a scholarship. She went to Daddy. I said, Daddy, molecular biology? Mummy asked me what that is. I said, well, it's me. I can't even spell it. But that's where we have come to. We also have a young lady now that's going up on the SpaceX. Look at Bahamas.
We have to create the opportunities for our kids to come back home. It's a bottleneck, and the children do not feel as if they can come back home.
We have to do that.
And I think he would want to see, and he'd want Bahamians to feel that pride that Mummy is showing you, that they felt, that you felt, that Obi felt, that we all felt growing up. There is something missing, and we need to find it, and we need to get it back, because the next generation is upon us very quickly, and we've got to teach them better than what we're teaching them now.
Obi, D is not acceptable is what Monique is saying. Your final words.
As I alluded to earlier, my perspective is always different. And coming from the painful perspective, I would like to see the generations to follow, to learn to argue and have differences of opinion and argue forcefully and be as strong as you can, but let's take the hate and the lowness and the dirt out of it. And as Minister Wilscombe alluded to earlier, he said that Daddy was always embracing young people. He spoke about, who was it, the youngest senator? Oh, Mr. Wilson? Oh, Sean?
Mr. McQueen,
the youngest senator. I remember very vividly in 1972 when Mr. Frankie Wilson was a candidate, and I think he was in his mid to late 20s. But incorporating, we still have very brilliant young minds out there. And I think as a people, we need to tap into their skill set a little more to continue that trend of bringing in the younger people and embracing the younger people so that they can learn from the experience ones who they are now and learn the good habits, see what the mistakes are, see what the bad habits are, and learn how not to, you know, repeat those. But we have a fantastic little country. Everywhere I travel, whether I'm traveling in the Caribbean or I'm traveling through the United States or I'm over in London visiting old friends from school, everybody loves the Bahamas. And they all want to be a part of what is your guys' secret up there. I was just in Trinidad for Carnival a couple of weeks ago, and they're fighting how where they could find U.S. dollars to change. And I said, you know, at home, we don't understand how fortunate we are. I just had a friend today. He's from Barbados, been married in the Bahamas for 30 years, had an appointment for his daughter to go to Florida tomorrow to have a dental appointment. The U.S. immigration officer refused him entry today because his visa expired tomorrow. I said, so why don't you just go to the police station and get a police record? He said, only Bahamian citizens have that opportunity. He said, with a Barbados passport, he can't travel from here with a police record. So there's so many benefits that we have as Bahamians that we take for granted, you know. And I just want the young people to understand that everything we have today, you as the next generation can duplicate that and make it even better and stronger.
I would just like to end to say that Sir Lyndon loved his Bahamas and he loved his people. And he always tried to make people feel as if they are somebody. He always tried to give people hope and make people feel good about themselves. And when I look at the TV screens and watch the young professionals, beautiful women, handsome young men, educated, probably leading private banking and whatever businesses in this country, I stopped and I said, and I shake my head and I said, this is what following him was all about. And I'm just so proud to see how far we have come. I'm just proud of and the love that we once held way back there in the early days will come back to us once more. And I just would like to leave it all. It's that love really is the answer for our country and our world. I want to thank you.
I am going to look to the producer and see if there are any questions. And I think that's it.
Any kids want to ask some questions?
Any children out there want to ask mother?
No.
No?
Mm-hmm.
Want them to.
Let's just... hasn't this been excellent? Rich? I'm telling you. Just checking to see if any questions have come through. As a matter of fact, I do have... two questions. It's for Minister Welshcombe. Oh, see them? Okay, we're going to be very quick. Here. We're going to just be a few more minutes.
Yes.
And
thank you. Wow.
She's doing this too.
I present you some flowers and I say thank you.
I thank you. I never have a bag. What a beautiful bag. Well, thank you very much. Gee, Christmas has come early.
Thank you very much.
You're speaking?
This makeup.
You speak?
I think there are a couple more presentations.
Under the stewardship of Sir Lyndon Pindling, the Bahamas established Bahamas Air, the Central Bank, the National Insurance Board, the Royal Bahamas Defense Force, and the Hotel Corporation. Of which accomplishment do you think he was most proud and why?
Whom is that directed to?
You want to
answer? Okay. Can you read that question one more time?
Yeah.
Let's get it.
Under the stewardship of Sir Lyndon Pindling, the Bahamas established Bahamas Air, the Central Bank, the National Insurance Board, the Royal Bahamas Defense Force, and the Hotel Corporation. Of which accomplishment do you think he was most proud and why?
National insurance.
Because it provided.
You said national insurance.
Well, when COVID came and nobody had a job,
Everybody lost their job. Everybody went to the sports center to collect what? A national insurance. That was our safety net. That was my father's safety net for everybody.
His second was the defense force.
Yes.
What were Sir Lyden Pindling's views on faith and religion and its role in the Bahamian political landscape?
I think that question can very easily be answered. The Bahamas is always referred to as a Christian nation. When you look at the preamble to the Constitution, it speaks about having an abiding faith in Christian principles. So the whole foundation of the country is based on Christian principles. You heard Mom say earlier, as a matter of fact, we as children didn't know that Daddy was a member of the Adventist Church until after he lost the election. And he went back to his church and he was rebaptized. So that would have been 92, he'd have been 62 years old. He went back to his faith. So clearly his whole emphasis on faith and religion, it was very important to him.
Did Sir Lyden Pindling ever share his dreams for his children? If he did, to what extent have his dreams for his family been fulfilled?
He never brought his work home. He never brought his work home. So when you say, did he ever share his dreams with his children? No, he didn't. Because when he was home, he was daddy. He was a prime minister. So whenever he did have the time, we were watching baseball games on TV or watching football games on television. Or, you know, when we were little children, taking us to the beach out on Saunders Beach, you know. So he was doing daddy things at home. He didn't bring the nation's work into the house.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let us give the Pindlings a round of applause. I do have the honor to welcome to the stage the head girl of Government High School and the leader of the debating team, who will come and provide a perspective on Sir Lyden Pindling. Let us welcome her.
Okay. Dear Sir Lyden Pindling, thank you. I think sometimes between constructive analysis of your leadership and the reverent but jubilant celebrations of your life and legacy, we sometimes forget to say thank you. Two simple words that express gratitude. Two simple words that express our appreciation for all that you did and all that you were and all that you inspire us to be. As head girl of the Government High School, I have already experienced just a little what you experience a lot of. The weight of responsibility, the expectation of excellence amongst your peers, the duty of service and the daily requirements of patience, humility, and strength. As a member of Generation Z, I unfortunately don't have the memories like the distinguished ladies and gentlemen that have shared so much with us this evening. I have sat in awe. I have sat in my seat, feeling that my generation has missed out on the opportunity to relish in your leadership, experience your tenacity, and bask in your strength. The great proverb states, a society grows great when old men plant trees in whose shade they shall never sit. I, along with so many young people, are benefiting today from what you, your wife, your family, and the leaders that surrounded you have planted into the development of this nation. And for that, we are grateful. For that, we are blessed. And for that, we should be challenged to build. To the young people sitting in this room or watching online, soaking in this wealth of knowledge, sitting in the shade of progress and nation building, I challenge you to press on, get involved, and build upon the foundations of our forefathers and foremothers. Don't sit in the shade and wait. Rather, appreciate that you have shade to shield you from the sun as you build. Tonight, take with you these lessons as shared about the life and legacy of the father of our nation. So Lyden Pindling was 37 when he became premier. So don't let age keep you sitting and waiting to build. So Lyden Pindling has attributed a lot of his success to the support of his life partner, Dame Margaret Pindling. So remember, you cannot build alone. Sir Lyden Pindling challenged what was, and he was unwavering in redefining what could be. Don't let tradition and the rhetoric of this is how it's always been keep you in the shadows. Sir Lyden Pindling forged ahead, broke barriers, defied odds, faced obstacles. Always remember, some trees may bend, but they never break. Sir Lyden Pindling inspired thousands and mentored so many. May you always remember, as you build, plant your own trees so that one day you'll provide shade for future leaders to sit in. Dear Sir Lyden Pindling, thank you. Thank you for navigating this nation through trying times and unprecedented levels of achievement. My generation will never know a time without majority rule, or for a young lady like myself having the ability to vote or the limitations of political and social oppression. We, however, are called to actively and aggressively address food security, economic independence, fight climate change, and the social ills we are facing today. But like you said, if Bahamians are not prepared to stand up and defend their own Bahamas, then we don't deserve to have it. So to truly build on the legacy of Sir Lyden Pindling, we must fight for a better, stronger, safer Bahamas. We must fight to protect our nation so that 50 years from now, generations to come, we will be able to sit in our shade. Thank you.
I do take note, Obi, she said the government high school. Ladies and gentlemen, we're near the end of our program this evening, but before doing so, may I invite the Prime Minister and may I invite the Secretariat, the Chair, may I invite Mr. Sean McQueenie and Mr. Franklin Wilson to join the family on stage for this once-of-a-lifetime photograph. And Mr. Shenandoah, would you kindly join us? Cartwright, who represents Leader of the Opposition. The Honorable Glenys Hannah-Martin, would you kindly? This is a once-in-a-lifetime shot that we'd wish to have. And the Honorable Perry Christie. Please. Honorable Ruby Ann Darling, is she here, please? Gentlemen, I want to thank you for a wonderful evening. Could you remain in your seats as the Pindling family and other prime minister and other members of the leadership of our country leaves
for the hands that you have loaned to me over 44 years. God bless you. And as I said, God bless the Bahamas. Long live the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, a rousing round of applause for a wonderful evening. We've come to the end of this masterclass, and I wish to thank you all for your attendance. On behalf of the National Independence Secretariat, we hope you enjoy this evening. We'd like to thank all participated, and we invite you to the foyer for a reception. Ladies and gentlemen, kindly remain in your seats, in your places, for the departure of the Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, Dame Marguerite and family, followed by Cabinet Ministers. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been a wonderful evening. Another thunderous round of applause.
You're watching the ZNS Network, the People's Station.